For many of us, Mars represents hope. From scientific discoveries, for example living organisms against all the odds, to the promise of colonization, the red planet may be key to our survival. Certainly, as life on Earth grows steadily more precarious, our second closest neighbor seems to present a viable alternative, even if some think that that's rather crazy. And in the video today, some facts about Mars that you might have missed. Number 10. Scientists observed a Martian civilization just last century. The astronomer William Herschel made some important observations of Mars, including its rotational period and the seasonal variation of its ice caps. But like many of his era, he also worked under the assumption that the planet was teeming with life. He saw the dark areas as oceans and observed vegetation on the supposed landmasses. He even suggested that intelligent Martians probably enjoyed a situation similar to our own. It was an idea that persisted for centuries. Hence, when Italian astronomer Giovanni Schiaparelli's description of canali, channels, on the surface was translated into English as canals, people imagined waterways constructed by a human-like society on Mars. And whatever he might have thought of the phenomena himself, his own maps only served to support this assumption, resembling, as they did, a sprawling port city sectioned into districts by canals. Other maps suggested an even more man-made thing, sort of like a Martian Venice. Even in the 20th century, the American astronomer Percival Lowell praised the Martians' ingenuity. According to him, the canals which he built a state-of-the-art observatory to view were likely constructed to transport water from the poles to the plains, perhaps in a bid to save life on Mars from extinction. There was evidence, he wrote, of a mind of no mean order, a mind certainly of considerably more comprehensiveness than that which presides over our own public works. By Lowell's time, most scientists saw these grooves in the landscape as natural geological phenomenon, but the idea of an advanced Martian civilization persisted in the popular imagination. The science fiction author Edgar Rice Burroughs was among those to encourage this belief, portraying a developed, albeit dying, world of majestic cities, warring humanoid races, and a fantastic bestiary of eight-legged horses, ten-legged dogs, and giant four-armed white apes, so ferocious they were among the leading causes of death on the planet. Number 9. Valles Marineris is the grandest canyon in the solar system. Valles Marineris cuts a deep scar across 20% of the circumference of Mars, extending an incredible 2,500 miles around the planet. It begins in the maze-like valleys of the Noctis Labyrinthus, Labyrinth of the Night, in the west, and abates in the smooth, crisp Planitia, Golden Plain, in the northeast. 373 miles across in places, with a maximum depth of roughly 5.5 miles, that's 30,000 feet, it's decidedly grander than the Grand Canyon on Earth. That trench extends a mere 497 miles in length and measures 18.6 miles across and is no more deep than 6,000 feet. The Valles Marineris is thought to have started as a crack in the surface of Mars, dating back to the cooling of the planet as it formed. This assumption is based on evidence of geological processes such as lava flows, collapsed pits from rushing water and floods, and glacier calving. Number 8. Global dust storms encircle the planet. Even regular dust storms on Mars are intense, lasting for weeks at a time and covering continent-sized areas. But once every 3 years, that's 5.5 Earth years, a mammoth, months-long dust storm encircles the entirety of the globe. As impressive a sight as that is, Martian dust storms are nowhere near as powerful as storms can get on Earth. In fact, since winds don't exceed 60 miles per hour, they're not even strong enough to qualify as Category 1 hurricanes, the weakest entry-level category. There's also less pressure on Mars anyway, so it would take considerably more force to create the same effect as on Earth. Simply put, Matt Damon probably wouldn't have been stranded by the storm at the beginning of The Martian. Indeed, the astronauts wouldn't have left in the first place. NASA actually has recordings of Martian winds. They've been recorded by NASA's InSight lander on Elysium Planitia on December 1, 2018. The pressure sensor recordings were so weak that they had to be sped up by a factor of 100 just to be audible. Martian winds aren't completely harmless, though. Dust particles are electrostatic, so they stick to surfaces upon contact. This is why Mars rovers look so filthy. Electrostatic dust is also problematic for mechanical moving parts as well as solar panels. The daily sweeping of solar panels in the Martian to keep their optimal efficiency was therefore something that the movie got very right. Number 7. The moons of Mars have different fates. Phobos, fear, and Deimos, panic, are named for the sons of Ares, the Greek god of war, aka Mars to the Romans, who pulled their father's chariot into battle. But they're not quite as imposing as they sound. Phobos is a mere 43 miles around, and Deimos is just 24 miles. Because of their irregular shapes, they're actually thought to be captured asteroids caught in Mars' gravitational pull, and because of their diminutive size, they both have very little gravity of their own. On Phobos, for example, you could easily throw a baseball into escape velocity, while on Deimos, you could ride a bike off a hill into space, which would probably be quite panic-inducing. The closer to Mars of the two is Phobos, orbiting the planet in just under a third of a day at a distance of 9,377 kilometers. Deimos takes roughly 1.25 days to complete its orbit, perambulating at a distance of 23,436 kilometers. By way of comparison, the Earth's moon at 384,400 kilometers has an orbit of almost a month, which is, of course, why we call it a month in the first place. Phobos' great speed means it's actually getting closer to Mars with each orbit. Eventually, it'll reach the Roche limit, an orbit so close to the planet that tidal forces pulling on the near and far sides of the moon are so powerfully opposed that they will simply break the moon into pieces. When that happens, it will probably form a ring around Mars, a ring that will later rain down upon the equator. Colonists needn't worry too much, though. This semi-apocalyptic scenario isn't expected to happen for some 30 to 50 million years. Deimos has a rather different fate. Similar to our own moon, it's gradually getting further away from the planet, and eventually it will just drift off into space. Number 6. Olympus Mons is the biggest volcano in the solar system. With a diameter of 374 miles, Olympus Mons is roughly the same size across as Arizona. Towering 16 miles high, it's also 3 times taller than Everest. In fact, Olympus Mons is so tall, you could effectively hike into space. One reason for its vast proportions is Mars's different geology. On Earth, crustal plates move over stationary hotspots to form new volcanoes and render old ones obsolete. But on Mars, the crust doesn't move. Instead, lava piles up over billions of years in one spot. Further, the lower gravity means the resulting mass weighs less than it would on Earth, allowing volcanoes to get much, much larger without collapsing. Olympus Mons is just the hugest of several volcanoes on Mars, all in the region of Tharsis. The next tallest in height, at 12.4 miles in height, is Arcia Mons, followed by Acrius Mons at 9.3 miles and Pavonis Mons at 8.9 miles. And it isn't just the biggest volcano in the solar system, but the biggest known mountain of any kind on any of the 8 planets. Only the asteroid Vesta is home to a higher peak, and there's only a 314-foot difference. Number 5. The red planet used to be blue. While notions of organized life on the surface of Mars have long since been quashed, we now know that the planet has water. And billions of years ago, it almost certainly had rivers, lakes, and seas, just like Earth. Digital visualizations give us a glimpse of what this may have looked like, either from within the early Martian atmosphere or from without, looking at the planet from space. In the latter case, a massive continent fills one side of the western hemisphere. The terrain ranges widely between glacial ice and tundra in the north and south, lush rainforests in the tropical and subtropical regions, and arid volcanic desert in the equatorial region around Mars's iconic Great Peaks. The other side is awash with a vast blue ocean flowing inland via the Valles Marineris. Although this image was created more to trigger the imagination than as an accurate scientific model, it certainly isn't unrealistic. Clay samples collected on Mars are evidence of ancient riverbeds, for example, while eroded cliffs are thought to describe the coastlines of former oceans or perhaps one giant ocean, incorporating the 4 to 5 kilometer deep, 2,003 kilometer wide Vastitis Borealis, or Northern Waste. Number 4. Mars could be blue in the future. The Martian atmosphere is now so thin, 0.6% the pressure of Earth's at sea level, that if you were to stand unprotected on the surface, your saliva, tears, and the moisture in your skin, along with any fluid in your lungs, would immediately and painfully evaporate. Of course, you'd also be unable to breathe the 96% CO2 air, or withstand for a very long time the average temperature of minus 81 degrees Fahrenheit. But if you did, there's also the ever-present hazard of meteorites. These are space rocks passing intact through Mars's ultra-scarce atmosphere. And as thin as it is at present, the atmosphere is still being lost into space, stripped away by solar winds at upwards of 100 grams per second. But even at this rate, it'll be another 2 billion years before Mars loses its atmosphere practically completely and ends up like the Moon or like Mercury. So there's hope. The expectation is that at some point, us humans will intervene, terraforming Mars by thickening the atmosphere and replenishing it to livable levels. There are a number of ways to do this, mostly involving the release of carbon dioxide locked up in ice and rocks. Orbital mirrors could be used to melt the polar ice caps, for instance, or thermonuclear bombs could be used to explode them, throwing dust into the air to further increase the greenhouse effect. Introducing gases like ammonia and methane would also help thicken the atmosphere. Further, this melted ice would flow naturally into the oceans. Over centuries, the carbon dioxide could be converted into breathable oxygen by plants or even possibly machines. Another way could be to seed the planet with microbial life to create the conditions of primordial Earth, then gradually introduce plant and animal life. However we recreate it, though, the atmosphere would again be sheared off into space for the same reason it's being lost in the first place. Mars lacks the magnetic field required to hold onto it. Paraterraforming, the terraforming of specific regions rich in carbon dioxide and housing them under domes, may be the most realistic alternative. But since any global atmosphere wouldn't be lost for many millions of years anyway, there should be ample time to construct a sphere around the entirety of the planet, thereby containing the terraformed Martian atmosphere. A shell world like this might feature artificial lights, hanging cities, and even gravity control, perhaps allowing humans to even fly. Number 3. The new space race is well underway. Efforts to colonize Mars are frequently in the news these days, and interestingly, they're being mostly undertaken by private enterprises. This is encouraging given the amount of bureaucracy that hinders national space programs. Although NASA under Trump aims to get people there by the 2030s, for instance, subsequent administrations' priorities might be rather different. The United Arab Emirates, which has relatively little in the way of bureaucratic red tape, may have a more realistic, albeit audacious, plan, and that's to house 600,000 in a new Martian city by 2117. But like Russia, which planned to send humans there this year, they haven't landed anything on Mars yet, not even so much as a probe. The private company Mars One famously put out a call for colonists in 2013 with no experience required, and the company plans to establish an outpost by 2026, sending the first humans there in 2031. When they arrive, they're expected to get to work setting up solar panels, food production units, and other essentials for long-term human survival. Odds are in favor of SpaceX, though, which plans to get there much sooner. Assuming everything goes to plan over the next few years, they could start building a propellant production plant on Mars by 2022. This would allow return trips and the establishment of viable long-term settlements, villages which would become cities, from as early as 2025. SpaceX founder Elon Musk actually gives himself a 70% chance of moving there by then. Ultimately, SpaceX intends to send millions of people to Mars. They don't think it will be without problems. Musk assumes people will die, but they do believe that it's well worth the risk. As they see it, Mars is just the first step. Long-term, SpaceX's Starship is envisioned as an interplanetary transport system, getting humans practically anywhere in the solar system and setting up propellant production plants along the way. Number 2. Life on Mars won't necessarily, or necessarily won't, be bleak. Despite the differences, for example, orange skies during the day and blue skies at sunset and sunrise, there are some striking similarities between Mars and Earth. A Martian day is just 40 minutes longer than ours. In contrast to a Venusian day that's 242 days longer than ours, and actually longer than a Venusian year. For example, a day on Mars is just 40 minutes longer than ours. Also, Mars's axis is tilted similarly to the Earth's, 25.19 degrees to our 23 degrees, resulting in comparable changes of season. But life will obviously be hard for the colonists, at least in the early days. Even if they do get to make a return journey, they'll probably have to stay for at least a couple of years to make the months-long journey worthwhile. And throughout this time, they're going to be confined to small spaces with only brief and occasional walks on the surface. Life will, however, probably get better in the long run. Indeed, it'll have to if it's going to attract anywhere near the kind of numbers required to make colonization a success, unless people go there simply to get away from Earth. In late 2018, architects released a series of concept images for how life on the red planet might look. Although primarily built to withstand harsh radiation and dust storms, as well as freezing temperatures, Martian homes, they say, will also have to be homely. Family residences are envisioned as geodesic domes set in protective caves, complete with soft lounging space and sentimental touches like shag rugs depicting the Earth from space and cuddly toys for the kids. There's also an inbuilt garage for personal rovers and a conservatory veranda with indoor garden space. Mansions for the more affluent have sleek modular designs stacked into the sides of a crater and enormous plate glass windows to survey the otherworldly view. Instead, views could be a live feed from the Martian surface or else programmed with views of Earth. Of course, virtual reality could allow for more immersive experiences of our home planet. Looking to the longer-term future, it's interesting to note that humans born on Mars will likely be taller than average. The lower gravity, one-third of Earth's, will allow the fluid between their vertebrae to expand, just as it does for astronauts in space. So born and bred Martians will probably avoid visiting Earth at all, since it would be the equivalent of us visiting a planet with three times the gravity of our own. Someone weighing 160 pounds on Mars would suddenly weigh almost 500 pounds on Earth, making it difficult to move around and potentially causing bone problems. Number 1. There may be life on Mars right now. Because Mars lost its atmosphere and the majority of its water gradually over a period of millions or billions of years, it's possible, even likely, that life evolved to survive the increasingly inhospitable conditions. Back in 1975, the year before the first Viking lander returned data and samples from the surface, Martians were envisioned as ground-based and fungal in appearance. Nowadays, we understand that life on Mars is probably a lot more limited and most likely to be found underground. It could be inhabiting lava tubes, for example, the large winding caves formed by ancient magma flows where subterranean water is heated by the planet's core. Researchers are currently working on an insect-like wall-climbing robot that will investigate. Life could also potentially be proliferating in underground saltwater lakes. Reported in 2018 based on radar data from the orbiting Mars Express, the first suspected lake of this type is around 1.5 kilometers beneath the surface, close to the South Pole, and at least 20 kilometers across. Magnesium, calcium, and sodium perchlorate salts are thought to act as antifreeze, keeping the water in a liquid, albeit inhospitably briny state. Comparable lakes in Antarctica are host to plenty of microbial life. Unfortunately, however, it's tricky to land craft at the southern pole of Mars, owing to the thinner atmosphere and rougher terrain of the region. Scientists will certainly endeavor to make it happen, though. In the meantime, we can only speculate as to what this life might be like. Percolate salts are toxic to most Earth life forms, but there is an ocean-dwelling bacteria that breaks down these salts using enzymes and converts them into chloride and oxygen in order to breathe. On Mars, it's also possible that microbes have evolved to breathe not oxygen, but methane, a gas that is known to seep from the planetary interior. Of course, Martians might not be microbial in nature, although the limitations of the planet's atmosphere and climate are assumed to restrict life forms to very simple expressions. Either way, the discovery of life on Mars will have ethical implications for colonization. Terraforming, in particular, could wipe out all existing life on the planet even before we have the chance of meeting it. But even the arrival of humans risks contamination. For this reason, the scientific community will probably impose restrictions on where human colonists can go. Areas designated special regions under a planetary protection policy will be strictly off limits, not just for the Martians' own safety, but also to prevent potentially deadly, potentially rapidly multiplying Martian bacteria from hitching a lift back to Earth. So I really hope you found that video interesting. If you did, please do give us a thumbs up below. And also don't forget to subscribe. We've got brand new videos just like this every day of the week. And if that's not enough for you, I've got another channel. It's called Biographics. We look at biographies of notable people from the present day as well as history. You can find a link to that on the screen now as well as below. And as always, thank you for watching.